This is Duke University.
Christ is risen. Grace and peace to you in Jesus Christ, our Lord, and happy Easter on this rainy day. Christ is risen in sunshine or in rain, and he is among us, and we are so glad to have you here. The mission of Duke Chapel is keeping the heart of the university listening to the heart of God, and we hope that you discover the heart of God today. There are many ways to be involved in our chapel community, and you'll find those in your bulletin. I encourage you to take a look. A quick word about logistics. You may know that we have a service starting after this service, so if you would be willing to leave, do your best to leave by the side aisles, that will allow the incoming people to be seated through the center aisle. That would be wonderful. And now let us stand and sing our Easter praises.
Thank you. Please be seated. Please join me in the prayer for illumination. God of life, through Jesus Christ, you have bestowed upon the world the light of life. As we hear your word today, sanctify this new fire and grant that our hearts and minds may also be kindled with holy desire to shine with the brightness of the risen Christ. Amen. The New Testament lesson is from Acts, the 10th chapter. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 20th chapter.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory Thou o'er death hast won. Resurrected Lord, come today and resurrect us. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Mary Magdalene has forgotten that it is Easter. According to one writer, there are three essential prayers: help, thanks, and wow. Easter is supposed to be a wow Sunday, right? Can I have a few witnesses to say wow? I just want to be sure that we're on the same page this morning. But Mary makes it a woe is me Sunday, not a wow Sunday. Come on, Mary. Don't rain on our Easter parade today or dampen the mood of our party. Don't wrinkle our frilly dresses or mess up our new fancy hairdos or crush our favorite white Easter lilies. Oh, Mary, don't you weep. But that's exactly what she does early on the first day of the week while it is still dark. Mary stood weeping outside the tomb in a pool of tears that drenched this story. One commentator says that this biblical text is awash in tears. The pages of this pericope are seemingly moist with Good Friday sorrow still, but it is trumpet-tongued, brass-blasting Easter at Duke Chapel. Yet Mary reveals that we are an Easter people living in a Good Friday world. Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. Weeping is more than tears. It's wailing and lamentation for the dead, and it's an ancient Jewish expression of mourning and grief. Why does Mary weep? She says, they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. Mary does not weep as a sign of the penitence of the gift of tears, nor does she weep over the bitter division in this country over human equality. Mary weeps because she mourns the loss of Jesus. The God she knew is gone. I did not say she mourned the death of Jesus in this case, because Jesus was already dead. She weeps because Jesus is lost. The one who declared his university major to be finding the lost was lost himself, and she couldn't find him. Her weeping, or what John Donne calls fruits of much grief, flow because of the presence of the absence of Jesus. Jesus is MIA, missing in action. Mary had gone to the tomb because that was where she was used to finding Jesus. The dead Jesus, the impotent Jesus, the Jesus who does not meddle in my life Jesus, comfortable and cozy Jesus. Mary had become used to the place of death, so she weeps, because what she had come to expect had shifted all of a sudden. Everything she knew, Jesus, was gone. She weeps due to a nostalgic disorientation. They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. Mary still expects to find a dead Jesus in a dark tomb, located in the same old place, acting in the same old way, controlled, cold, numb, and locked in a grave cave. Mary has forgotten that it is Easter. She weeps because she has lost what she has known to be reality. The usual place where she thought she could find Jesus forever, in that mausoleum manger. They have taken away my Lord, my personal Jesus, my concept who Jesus is. Oh, I wish I could return to the days when it was as simple as Jesus is the answer. A simpler way, no complexity to theology, no unanswered questions because the Bible tells me so. The good old days when I ruled God from the throne of my own anxiety and wrapped and entombed Jesus, not in swaddling clothes, but in a psychological safety blanket. That dead Jesus was gone for Mary. Where she left him, he could no longer be found. The Jesus she knew and believed in was lost. The tame Jesus of her childhood, the one with blonde hair, blue eyes, and a pointy nose on the fans used in the country church, her Jesus, her Lord, was lost. The one she understood, the dead Jesus laying in a dead place, a Good Friday world for an Easter people. This is in stark contrast to what Anne Lamott dreams about in her book Plan B, Further Thoughts on Faith. She dreams of an Easter like the resurrection vision of a child in Sunday school who drew an Easter bunny, not Mary, outside of the empty tomb, joining eternal life with a basket full of chocolate eggs. With that vision, the tomb would be tasty, yummy, yummy to my tummy. What an Easter it would be. Chocolate, white chocolate with macadamia nuts, dark chocolate melted over strawberries, Hershey chocolate ice cream cake, chocolate covered grits with scrambled eggs. Maybe, or maybe not. Either way, scientists have argued for years how eating sweet chocolate makes us feel good and is more pleasurable than listening to your favorite music or winning the lottery or even falling in love. Don't let your significant other know that secret. But chocolate can lift you to heights you've never seen before, they say. And a 2012 article in the New England Journal of Medicine argues that chocolate consumption contributes to one becoming a Nobel Prize winner. With that theory, this is a true article. We probably have a house full of Nobel laureates this morning. Anne Lamott dreams of a chocolatey Christmas or Easter. Innocent, childlike, carefree, full of chocolate fountains flowing deep and wide outside the tomb with the Easter bunny as the doorman. This is a dream. Not the reality she knows. On the contrary, she's not surprised by Mary's weeping in a Good Friday world. Mary, not the Easter bunny, stood outside of the tomb without a full basket of chocolate eggs, but carrying despair and hope in the chest of her heart. Mary weeps because she finds herself in a Good Friday predicament on Easter morning. What else could she do in this situation? She could post a jazzy and flashy neon-colored flyer with Jesus's picture on it and put missing at the top and hang it outside of the Bryan Center. But how could she do it when it seems as if Mary doesn't even know what Jesus looks like anymore? She had lost Jesus, or at least her conception of him. She had gotten so used to a dead Jesus that a living Jesus was a stranger to her. And how strange this is, because Mary actually learns how to weep from Jesus who wept at the tomb of Lazarus. She picks up where he left off, weeping. Mary loves Jesus and her tears are a sign of that grieving love, but maybe the flood of tears blind her eyes so she doesn't recognize Jesus when Jesus asks her face to face, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" She saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. She sees him, but she doesn't see him with the eyes of faith. You can love someone, but once that person changes, you may not recognize him or her anymore. They may be so different because death and life are different. A dead Jesus is distinct from a living Jesus. UNC's men's basketball is different from Duke's men's basketball, and we know who's dead and who's still alive in the tournament. Jesus had changed clothes because he was alive and shook off the sting of death's designer attire, because death's clothing won't fit on a living God. Jesus left his tomb linen suit in the deathbed of the grave and was now wearing living clothes of light. The question, whom are you looking for, suggests that the real issue was that Mary was looking for the wrong Jesus, a powerless dead Jesus in a cold tomb just laying there, not a risen living Jesus and Lord. She doesn't recognize him because she wasn't used to a living risen Jesus. She looked for him in the wrong places and had gotten used to a God who just lies dead, inactive. A small, lifeless Jesus she could control and even carry away, as she offers to take him away if she can find out where he lays. But the living Jesus stands right in front of her, looking right at her. Then Comedy Central arrives in the midst of a tragic time. After Jesus asks her why she's weeping and who she's looking for, Mary speaks to him, supposing him to be the gardener. She's talking to the incarnate God, but thinks he's a gardener. That's like walking around in a department store shopping and someone asks you if you know what row the Clorox bleach is on, and you weren't even wearing an employee name tag. What made Mary think that Jesus was a gardener? Was it his tattered clothes, or his accent, or his humble demeanor, or his skin color, or his body odor? Was it that he resembled God at the Garden of Eden? Was it the sweat on his brow, or the scars in his hands? A gardener? That's like someone saying to me, "You look like a preacher." Well, they may be right, but what's that supposed to mean? You can't always judge a book by its cover. The writer of Hebrews teaches us not to neglect showing hospitality to strangers, because by doing so, some have entertained angels without knowing it. Mary was entertaining the resurrected God, but she didn't know it. She saw a gardener. According to various accounts, Sir Winston Churchill did not have the greatest relationship with his parents. As a young boy, he was berated by his father, and who told him that he would grow up to be a failure. They perceived him to be less than what he was. What they saw, he was not. And on top of that, he had a speech impediment and was discouraged by some of his teachers. Sadly, most of us have probably had a teacher or a school counselor like that who only knew how to be a midwife for stillborn hope. Yet Churchill became one of the major 20th century leaders in the world. You can't judge a book by its cover. Too small, too big, too tall, too short, too thick, too thin, too loud, too soft, too uneducated, too unsophisticated, too human to be divine. Jesus can be right in front of us, but we don't recognize him because we think he's just a yard maintenance man. Our lack of recognition keeps us weeping in the dark of dawn. Even when resurrection comes, we may not recognize it, because we've become so used to, so familiar with crucifixions, dying, and death. And as the psychologists have taught, familiarity breeds liking. Liking death can become the norm when we hold membership at the Jerusalem Temple of the Tomb. Those who attend services there are dead too, among the saintly zombies, or at least counting down to the date of their own death on the website deathclock.com. Check that website out. No wonder weeping occurs. That is, weeping over our own death. Perhaps Mary weeps because a part of her dies when Jesus died. I don't know, but I do know that she weeps because of disorientation due to her losing her Jesus, the dead Jesus. But she's the one who's really lost, because she doesn't know resurrection when it's even staring her in the face. Good Friday weeping on Easter intrigues me, and I guess it makes sense. That's why some of my former students at Princeton Seminary used to call me the doctor of death. Mary's weeping is fascinating, but I wonder something else about her weeping. Unwittingly, perhaps, Mary weeps even as a deep yearning for the return of Christ. In fact, she weeps for resurrection as a summons, as an invocation for the presence of the risen Lord. She doesn't know this, but her tears are prayers. Sometimes we cry and we don't even know why. We're weeping for resurrection. And just as at the tomb of Lazarus, Jesus' tears inaugurated the triumph of life over death, so too the tears here inaugurate the triumph of life over death. In this context, we're reminded of the words of Jesus: I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus, the one who rises and calls us by name. Mary, even if we don't recognize him, even if we think he's still dead, he's calling you. The risen, living Jesus refuses to be imprisoned in death's solitary confinement. This living Jesus cannot be controlled by our theological paradigms or ecclesial traditions embalmed in a tomb. We won't find the living Lord of light there, dressed in death's dingy clothes. Jesus is alive and on the move in the world, which is why he tells Mary, "Do not hold on to me. You can't control me. You can't hold me down or hold me back or keep me dead and useless. There's too much work to do in the world, too much interceding and healing and comforting and reconciling, bringing peace in the midst of conflict, love where there is hatred, justice where there is oppression. Do not hold on to me with your sanctified straitjacket. Release me for the work of redemption, to ascend to the Father in order to lift you higher. Don't look for me at the tomb. You'll look for me and I'll be gone. I'm not there. I won't bring you back to the way it was, because I'm no longer dead. The way out of the darkness is only by moving ahead into my resurrection light. Don't dwell on the memories of the past, but remember the future I have for you. Why are you weeping?" Mary weeps not because she fears death, but because she fears life, the new, adventurous, unpredictable, resurrected life and future in Christ. The old, lost, dead, predictable, comfortable ways, dead Jesus had passed away. Behold, the living Jesus was making all things new. Weeping for all things new, a new start, a new beginning, a new day, when there will be no more tragedy and agony. All things new. What we see in the flesh of the risen Lord is God's embodied promise that a new day has begun in Christ and that resurrections still happen. All things new. A new start with your family that had fallen apart. A new job when you've lost a job. A new dream for your life when you thought all you were capable of were nightmares. A new medical invention that may actually help cure cancer. All things new. because Jesus got up, we can get up as he lifts us up as he ascends to the Father. Mary was down, but when Jesus calls her name, he lifts her spirit up. He wakes her up. He resurrects her, which is why she had been weeping for resurrection all along. Mary hoped for all things new. Mary's weeping ceases in the presence of the resurrected Christ. She was dead, but in that moment, he made her alive. She no longer needed a dead Jesus because a living one was right in front of her. Mary had seen the Lord, and her life was never the same again. She became an apostle to the apostles. After all she had been through in the past, this was an unexpected future. We can't control the future of Christ, but Christ leads us into the future and holds the future. We can't hold on to him because he's actually holding us. Why are you weeping? Oh, Mary, don't you weep. Mothers, don't you weep. Fathers, don't you weep. Sons, don't you weep. Daughters, don't you weep. Students, don't you weep. Faculty, don't you weep. Facility workers, don't you weep. Coaches, don't you weep. University administrators and staff, don't you weep. Because in the life of the risen Christ, we pass from death to life, from death's tomb to God's triumph, from an old age to the inauguration of a new one, an age when God will wipe every tear from our eyes, an age when death will be no more and crying and pain will be no more, an age where we just might eat chocolate for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Mary had forgotten Easter in her Good Friday world. But she no longer weeps, and we no longer have to sing, "Oh Mary, don't you weep." For weeping may endure for the night, but Easter joy comes in the morning. This morning, Jesus is not dead. He is alive. I told you it was a wow Sunday. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Not even Easter bunny chocolate can beat that.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of resurrection and new life, flood all creation with the joy of your resurrection. Be among those like Mary who are weeping and whose lives are awash in tears today. Cherish any who are overwhelmed, ashamed, lonely, humiliated. Refresh with your grace all who yearn for their grief to be turned into laughter. Spread your wings of hope over those who want to know your joy, but feel the earth just keeps opening up beneath them. On this day, we celebrate the empty tomb. We bring before you all those who stand at the grave of a loved one. Wrap your arms around those who are simply missing someone who is dear to them. Draw near to any who are broken in spirit today. Awaken us to the people in our lives who are suffering, and grant us the strength and grace to share their tears and to walk with them through great difficulty. Lord, in your mercy. God who opens the tomb, in Christ's resurrection we see your glory, your promise, and your new and abundant life. Be present with us now and open our eyes to places of resurrection and of new beginnings. Grant us knowledge of your joy. Through vocation, through friendships and family, through faith and laughter. Help us to hold fast to our Easter faith, even when the lilies fade and the choir and brass go silent. Hold close to your heart any who feel that there are things in their life that are too heavy, too complicated, too large to be overcome. Make your grace known to all those who feel that their life is disintegrating around them. When we find ourselves in the midst of forsaken and uncomfortable places, grant us the vision to recognize your signs of new life. Lord, in your mercy. God who transforms darkness to light, in the times we, your people, struggle to trust in your resurrected life, give us the assurance of your resurrection. Make it real and tangible and living for us. May the light of your life overwhelm the brokenness of ours. We remember before you any who find resurrection difficult to see and experience. Scatter the darkness in places that daily face violence, persecution, or grief. Breathe your peace into the political upheaval and unrest affecting North and South Korea. Protect the people of Syria who continue to live with uncertainty. Comfort all those who are afraid today. As we celebrate the joy of Easter morning, we ask that you are born anew in us. Touch our hearts and give us the courage to walk the journey of joyful discipleship and transforming love. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Father, who triumphs over death that we might have life, live in us today and every day, that all the world might come to know your amazing grace. Amen. Today's offering will go to the Pathways program. That is the part of the chapel's life that allows us to work with undergrads. Let us give our gifts with joy.
Ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion. If you have someone or something heavy on your heart, they would be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Thanks and praise fill our hearts, Almighty God, for you are the Lord of creation and new creation, of covenant and new covenant. You brought your promised people out of slavery to freedom in the promised land, and you brought your Son through the waters of death to the full glory of resurrection life. And so we gladly thank you, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Joy and gladness are our song, transforming God. For in your conquest of death, we see the destiny of every hope in you. Come among us in the power of your Holy Spirit, that your people may be blessed with power and grace, and that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup also, gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Hope and glory are our breath, merciful God. For you have rolled away the stone of despair, the stone of oppression, the stone of lament, the stone of grief, the stone of death, the stone of sin, the stone of fear. Come and stand among us and breathe on us your peace. Breathe on us your power. Breathe on us your eternal life, that all who labor, all who stumble, all who hunger, and all who fall shall meet you in the breaking of the bread and be lifted up by your touch. Shape your church to be your risen body. Make our scars beautiful like your scars. Make our lives life-giving like your life. And make our communion holy with your saints until you come again in glory and we eat with you in your kingdom. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, ever one God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ's broken body shines with resurrection light. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Please stand. Lord God, you make our hearts leap with alleluias in a resurrection song. We praise you for your abundant mercy, your bountiful grace, and your endless love. Most of all, we praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In his death and resurrection, he overcomes death, dismantles sin, and reunites us with you forever. Because of your Son, our eyes and hearts may overflow with fountains of joy. Fill us with the imagination of your kingdom, that we might be caught in wonder of the mercy, grace, and kindness and joy of everlasting life with you. Make our feet dance to the melody of your love, so the world might be drawn to you and in wonder and praise. Amen. May all our tears, all our hopes, and all our fears be taken up in resurrection glory. And may the light of Jesus so shine through you that the world may see the risen Christ and give glory to God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.